Minyan, there was a young Avrech, a young man who just recently came to the Breslev, and he was going through Gehinnom, going through hell. But since he came to Breslev, everyone was against him, his wife, his parents, his in-laws, his Rebbeim, his Mashpim, his friends. He was going through a major, major difficulty. So then, Rabbi Avraham Shtern Hartzan Cholam on Pesach, he davened together with the young man, and after the davening, he greeted him, he said shalom, and anyone who was new, he spent a lot of time talking to him, even though he was a very busy person, always davening and learning. So he turned to him, he saw that he was suffering. He said, what's wrong? And he said, since I came to Breslev, my whole life is being turned upside down. So he said to him many words of encouragement, and at the end he said like this. He said, "Nu, today is Pesach. And it's known that Pesach has the exact same gematria as Nachman. Pesach Mechet 148 is like Nachman 148. How can we connect the ideas of Pesach with Rabbi Nachman? Like what it says in the Haggadah, it says by Korech, that this is what Hillel did, Zecher LeMikdash KeHillel. What did Hillel do? He took the Pesach and ate it together with the Maror and the Matzah. Which means, in order to taste of Pesach, of this tzaddik, Rabbi Nachman and his teachings, it comes with a lot of maror, a lot of bitterness, and it comes with a lot of matzah. Matzah, Rabbi Nachman teaches in lesson Hey in the Kutei Moran, is milashon matzuta umeriva, machloket, difficulties. So it comes as a package deal. This is halachas like Hillel. But the Haggadah says afterwards, ein maftirin achar ha-pesach, ela afikoman. Just that. At the end, though, what stays in the mouth? Only the taste of the Korban Pesach, which means that it's only temporary. The difficulties a person is presented to in coming close to Rabbi Nachman and his teachings, whatever, is a temporary thing. Afterwards, the maror falls, and the matzah, the machloket falls, and what's left is just the ta'am Pesach. In light with this, there's an amazing story. Many people know the story, but it's worth going over the story because there's more precisions, more diukim on the story that come out. What's the story of the bitter herb? It's Rabbi Nachman's famous story of the bitter herb. We'll go over it again because there's some amazing precisions that come out of the story that people don't pay attention when they hear the story. The story goes like this, that there was once a Jewish beggar, a Jewish hobo, and also he had a friend with him, a goy, a German beggar. They were together. They would go collecting food and whatever, storing together. And came before Pesach time, and the Jew got excited. He was telling his Goyish friend, this is a special time, it's the one time of the year we get a full meal, get a great meal, the Seder night, everybody's invited. And he started depicting to the Goyish friend all the Seder, what they eat, all the delicious foods. So he said, you know, I have an idea. German is very close to Yiddish. I can make you up like you're a Yid, I'll pretend that you're a Jew, we'll dress you up a little. And I'll teach you some little things here to say Amen, to say Baruch Baruch Shema, you know, he'll teach him something. And also he said, I'll prepare you also for the Seder. Come with me to the shul on the night of Pesach, and just like I'll be invited by some family, you'll also be invited. And then afterwards we'll meet together back in the shul. So he did that, he trained him, and he taught him many of the customs of the night of the Seder, Kadesh, Orchatz, but he didn't mention to him Maror. He forgot to tell him about Maror. Right. So came the night of Pesach, and he everything was planned. They went to shul together. He was invited. He said, "Okay, we'll meet each other afterwards. We'll come back together, meet each other then." So afterwards, he was invited. He went to the family. He knew Kadesh. He noticed he stood up and said Amen. His friend trained him. Kadesh, Orchatz, washing the hands, right? Karpas, okay. Yachatz. Then Magid, but he didn't know what Magid would take so long. An hour and a half, 2 hours. And he's starving, he wants to eat, he's waiting. It's a long time. So then finally they finished the Magid, and then they start doing the what he was told about the matzah, motzi matzah, right? So he was getting excited, the meal's coming, they ate the matzah ready. Then they see that they bring on a nice silver platter, this funny looking type of herb that he never saw in his life, a horseradish. And he wasn't used to seeing horseradish. So they're putting on a nice lavish silver platter, the horseradish, and he sees how they're carefully slicing it and giving to each person. He said to himself, what? Is this the meal? Is this maybe this is a special thing my friend didn't tell me about? Some special type of herb? So they were giving out to people. He took a big portion, more than the average. And they came to eat it. He said, Amen. And he put it in his mouth, and it was burning. And then he got up. He couldn't handle it. And he screamed out to them, filthy Jews, dirty Jews, stupid Jews, all this devotion, all this ceremony for this. What is this? And he left, and he took off. And he went, bitterly went to the shul, hungry, empty stomach, going to sleep on a bench until his friend would come. So, after several hours, the other Jew came, and after a full meal, he comes, he sees his friend there lying on the bench, he wakes him up, how was it, don't talk to me, I don't want to look at you, what did you do to me, you played games on me, you stupid Jews, whatever. He said, what happened? And he told him what happened. He said, you're the idiot. Why? Right after that, they were going to bring out the good food that I told you about. Okay, it was a little point that we didn't speak about, if you would have just waited a little, you would have had it. So with this, Rabbi Nachman, he concludes this idea that patience is needed in life. This happens again and again and again. That the reason why people just drop everything is because they don't have that key of patience. The bitterness gets too strong. But now, if we look at the story carefully, he didn't know that there was something good coming up afterwards. He thought it was all a trick, because the bitterness, he wasn't warned. He wasn't warned beforehand. The bitterness came unexpectedly. And also the meal that he was told about, where is it? Whereas a Jew knows of the other guy, he tasted already the meal. He's been to a seder before. He knows what's waiting for him, and he knows the bitterness is temporary. And this is how it is in life, that when a person gets a taste of the Shulchan Orech, of the set table, so he's willing to endure, because I've tasted already the light. I've tasted already something beyond. I know that after being exposed to that, if afterwards things are taken away from me, and there's like a darkness, and it's a test of just patience to hold on, I'm more ready and willing to do so, because I've already experienced that I know what's out there. So I know to hold on. And this is an amazing rule in life, is that when you have patience, visit Hashem, you get to the silver platter, you get to the Shulchan Aruch, you get to the table. But it's all just a matter of patience, of waiting. It's an amazing, amazing messer in life, because the majority of people, when life just gets, it's too stressed and everything, they just drop everything, because I can't handle it, I'm just going to drop now. Wait a little, wait, that's the secret of
Judaism. That's why you have to wait half an
hour. Wait, also, this is the next year, the waiting, the test is preparation. You gotta wait, because that's the secret of coming to what you need. They say that salvation comes to those who wait for it. And why? You have to wait at the door until they open it. Because if you leave, so they open the door and you're not there, you're not going to get it. It's very obvious. This is learned out by Avraham Avinu. It says by Avraham Avinu that Hu yoshev petach ha'ohel kechom hayom. He was sitting at the entrance of the tent in the heat of the day. What does that mean? The heat of the day was being heated up by the Yetzara, by the Ta'avot. That's the chom hayom. And Avraham Avinu represents every Jew. And the petach ha'ohel, the entrance to the tent, is closed. And he's waiting. In the meantime, he's being heated up. Avraham represents every Jew. Hu yoshev petach ha'ohel kechom hayom. Commensurate in relationship to the heat of the day, he's being heated up. They're heating him up, all types of temptations and desires. I'm waiting for them to open the tent, to open the doors of Kedusha for me. Hu yoshev petach ha'ohel kechom hayom. This is Avraham Avinu. This is the patience. This is something which is so necessary in life. Everyone who's gone through or is going through life sees this. That patience is needed for every area of life, especially for Kedusha, especially for the high aspirations that a Jew has to come closer to Hashem, to finally come to davening, a total dveikut, a total connection to God in my davening, a total awareness of Hashem in my life, a level of being a tzaddik. It's all in patience and waiting for them and to keep on supplicating. The majority of people, they can't handle it, they leave. I can't wait and wait and wait and wait. And people also have a difficulty saying, until when am I supposed to wait? Until after I'm dead? It's a very common expression by people. How long am I going to wait for? When? I should be around when they open the door finally. Don't tell me I'm going to wait. And then only after I pass, then they're going to open the door. It's not how it is. That's part of the test of the Yetzara, that just to drop it because you're not going to be able to hold on anymore. But there's always a rule that Hashem lo ba bitrunya in briyotam. Hashem doesn't come with severity, with high demands to his creations. He sends a person what they can handle. If Hashem knows that a person can handle a lot, so that's why he's being sent this situation. Rav Nosson writes something amazing in the Kutei Halachot, Birkot Hashem Halacha Gimel. He says that if a person sees that the Yetzer Hara is really after him, he's really attacking him, making his life upside down, so you should feel very proud of yourself. I'm somebody special. If the Yetzer Hara is investing this time in somebody like me, and in my eyes I thought it was a nobody, I thought it was just a regular guy, leave me alone. But the fact that the Yetzer Hara is spending, investing his time to knock me down, I must be a somebody, I must be something special. Or else why would you invest so much time in me? This Rav Nosson teaches an amazing chizuk when a person feels thoughts of futility and it's just, it's too much and I can't handle it and this is not for me, whatever. Just the ajaba, the reason why you're going through what you're going through is because you're somebody special, and the only way to squeeze out from potential to actual is this obstacles, and you're holding on and waiting for it to open, that they open the doors, and Bezat Hashem, things happen. So this is an amazing message of Pesach, of the Seder, of the story of the Maror. There's some insights in that. Another amazing point to mention tonight is the power of prayer. The power of the prayer, especially of a person who's a pauper. It says in the Zohar Kadosh that in the 150 chapters of Tehillim, you have three psalms which begin with the word Tefillah. You have Tefillah le-David, Tefillah le-Ani, Tefillah le-Moshe. Right? You have Tefillah le-Moshe, chapter 90, Tefillah le-Ani, I think it's 102, 103. And you have Tefillah le-David, also like we say every day in the morning, the Shacharis. So the Zohar Kadosh asks, of these three, which is the greatest one? You would think Tefillah le-Moshe, Moshe Rabbeinu, no. Tefillah de David, David HaMelech, no. What is the greatest one? Tefillah de Ani, the prayer of a pauper, of a poor man. The Zohar says, why? Because it comes from a broken heart. His broken heart is so precious in front of Hashem's eyes that it even surpasses even the prayer of Moshe Rabbeinu and David HaMelech.
Can't I have a broken heart if I have some money? One second.
So the Zohar says, prove it. That's a high statement. They say that a poor person, his prayer will bypass even the prayer of Moshe Rabbeinu and David HaMelech. Prove that. So the Zohar says, look at the grammar, the diktuk of the word, the next word. It says, Tefillah la'ani ki ya'atof. The prayer of the poor person, because it covers up. And the word ya'atof means A is covering up B. Because if it meant that the poor person is covering himself with his, he's using his prayer, Tefillah la'ani ki ya'atof, with his prayer he's cloaking himself, so the grammar should have been ki hit'atef. But that it says ki ya'atof shows that his prayer of the poor person is covering something else up. What is it covering up? The prayers of David HaMelech and of Moshe Rabbeinu. This is what the Zohar says on someone who's poor even physically. He has no money in his pocket, whatever. Rav Nosson writes, this is all the more so for a person who feels his poverty spiritually. He feels how far he is from Hashem. Why am I going through this, Hashem? I'm so far from you and I want to be a better Jew. I want to come close to you. When? Ad matai. That brokenheartedness bypasses everything. Even the prayer of Moshe Rabbeinu and even the prayer of David HaMelech. Because Lev Nishbar Benitke Elohim Lotivzeh. A broken heart, Hashem doesn't push away. This is one of the greatest things in the world, is the broken heart of the Jew. When the heart is broken, then what's in the heart comes out. So it's like anything you break, what's inside, it falls and comes out. So too, when a person has a Lev Nishbar, his inner essence comes out. And by this is the greatest thing. Sometimes a person goes through a difficulty for such a long period, until after like maybe 10 years, 20 years, he lets out a krechts. And they say in heaven, we're waiting 20 years to get out this krechts from you. It took 20 years to get it. It was worth it, because now that this krechts came out, everything now will change Bezat Hashem for the good. That's how it is in life sometimes. He says, Rav Nosson, that mamash, a person doesn't necessarily see the salvation immediately, but it comes. If you wait for it, the door opens. He says that the salvation comes for those who wait for it. And very few are those who wait for salvation. There's a story told about the Rikanti. The Rikanti is one of the deep Mefarshim on the Humash, based on the Kabbalah. This man, Rikanti, this Rav Rikanti, he wrote it at the age of 83. This the story about Rikanti is unbelievable. They say when he was already a child, or 85 even, so 85 he wrote it. Already at 5 years old, when he was a little child in Cheder, he saw that he wasn't advancing intellectually like the other kids in kindergarten, when they're learning Aleph, Bet, and the Siddur and everything, at age 5, age 6. he saw that he wasn't advancing and he had a very thick head. And his whole life he saw that. He saw it later on at age 10, 15, 20 that he didn't have a strong head to learn, to learn, to daven. He wasn't there. He spent 80 years, it says, davening. Hashem, open my head. Open my da'at. Give me da'at. Give me words. 80 years. 80 years, it says about him. And at age 85, 86, whatever, again, 80 years later, he had a dream. He saw someone in white, apparently Avraham Avinu, and he was holding a cup with water, and he said, drink from this water. And he drank from it. He woke up. His eyes were open. You just look at the Chumash. And all of a sudden, all these chidushim started to come out, and that's the Rekanti that we have today. The Rekanti, this unbelievable perush, based on the couple of Rekanti, is after 80 years of davening, 80 years of yearning, 85, his mind was open, and he wrote this unbelievably deep commentary on the Chumash based on the Kabbalah. But the idea of waiting is something, it's one of the trademarks of Rabbi Nachman's teachings, is Hamten, he says, you have to wait. You have to keep on waiting until when? You have to wait until they open the door. When? You don't know. Nobody knows. But if you wait, you are guaranteed that they will open the door.
How long did he live?
Sorry?
How long did he live?
I don't know exactly.
Long enough to write the book.
For sure, after 85.
For sure.
I have no idea. I have to look at this history books. Art's possible on the Rishonim, the early Achronim, something like that. You can find his biography there. And also Shem Magdolim by the Chida. I don't know exactly his date of his passing. But this story is told a lot to show that there's always hope no matter what. You have to just keep on yearning and keep on going. And the reason why many people did not make it in life...
Is this an election night speech?
What?
Is this an election night
speech? This is an election night for Netzach, for in the long run, long term election that we should elect ourselves as making it, to becoming tzaddikim and fulfilling our purpose in this world, Bezat Hashem.
Amen.
Now, one more story, a very powerful story of a side story which I saw, which is very, very powerful. It always gets to me, and it's worth sharing this story. There was a wrestler chassid. His name was Rav Pinchas Yehoshua. He was a disciple of Rav Nosson of Breslov. So he lived like in the 1840s, 1850s. He lived way after Rav Nosson also, he passed him. This Rav Pinchas Yehoshua, by the year 1895, was very old. And one eve of Rosh Chodesh, one Erev Rosh Chodesh, he went to Davin by Rabbi Nachman's Kever in Uman with two younger Breslov Hasidim, Rav Avraham Sternhartz and his brother, Rav Mordechai Shuv, Shochet Ubodek. They went together to Davin Erev Rosh Chodesh, and they were davening. And Rav Avraham Sternhartz and the other Rav Mordechai, they finished their davening earlier. And they were waiting outside of Rabbi Nachman's kever for Pinchas Yehoshua, who was older. They were waiting because he was old. He needed help to escort him to walk down the hill. Rabbi Nachman's buried on a slope, going downwards and then going up. So they were waiting to help him. So when he finished davening, he was happy to see that they were waiting for him. And when he walked to them, he approached them, he froze. And then he let out a krechts, a very deep scream, like out of pain. Then he began to look at himself. He was looking at his hand, looking at his arms, and looking at himself like this. And they were looking at each other. Rabbi Sternhartz and Mordechai, what's the story with it? What's going on? So he told them, Rabboisai, I've just been given a revelation of all of my reincarnations until now. And he started to go ahead and list all of his Gilgulim from the time before the Tanaim, the Amoraim. He was in this time, that time, this time of this Atana, this Amora. He went into details. Rabbi Sternhartz wrote this story in his book. It's called Tovot Zichronot. He didn't list the details of all the Gilgulim, but he said he started to tell us all of his reincarnations that he came back. And he said like this with Pinchas Yehoshua. He said, I had the good fortune in every generation that I came back, I knew in every generation who was the leading tzaddik of that generation. He was a leading tzaddik, just like there was Moshe's Rashi Tivot Mashe Hayahu Sheyeh. What that which was is what will be. That means every generation, there is an aspect of Moshe Rabbeinu that comes back. There's a Tzaddik Ador. This concept of a Tzaddik Ador, like in Moshe Rabbeinu's time, comes back again and again. So he said he knew, it was aware to him, that who was that leading Tzaddik in every generation. And he went to him. And he came to him to help him, to ask him, give me a tikkun, help me, rectify me, that I can not come back again to this world. And he said that he was so crooked, his neshama, because of his blemishes that he had done in the previous reincarnations, that which afterwards he came back into the next tzaddik, the next generation, to ask for help. He said it was so blemished that they gave up on him. And he gave an analogy of a mason. A mason who prepares the bricks in the building. So he makes the first level, and then when it's finished, the second level, the third, the fourth. Sometimes a mason comes across a very odd-shaped stone that even if he chips and chisels it on one end, it doesn't match the second side. So he fixed that end, it doesn't match the third side. It's so odd, it's so awkward, that even if he tries to fix it, he can't use it. He can't use it, so he disposes of it. So he said, what it says in Echa, Tishtapechna Avni Kodesh, what Yirmiyah is lamenting in Echa, that the holy stones are being poured out on the streets, and Rashi explains, the Midrash explains, referring to the Jewish souls, they're called stones. So he said, Rabbi Pinchas Yeshua, that the souls are like stones, okay? And the tzaddikim, they take the souls of Am Yisrael to rectify them, and they put them in this building, this construct of the Mishkan, of making a spiritual building with the souls of Am Yisrael. When it's complete, Mashiach will come. So all the tzaddikim in every generation, we're talking big tzaddikim, big shots, who are involved in what's called Tikkun Olam, a higher level, as opposed to a local Rav and a local tzaddik for blessings and everything. You have these tzaddikim at the level, the caliber of Moshe Rabbeinu, who are looking at the world on a higher, much plane, a higher level, and looking at the picture in as a whole of Am Yisrael, as their souls in the makeup of the complete picture of creation, which is in order to bring the final Geulah, the third temple, a spiritual building, an edifice has to be made with the souls of Am Yisrael. Each soul is a part, is a brick in this building. Each soul that's rectified gets put in. That's it, it's done. If it's finished, the tikkun. If it's not finished, then he can't put it in yet. So, when this building will be finished, finally, the Mashiach will come, his edition. So he said, my soul was so upside down, so crooked, I went to the Tana, for example, I said, help me, you know, fix me. I know I'm blemished, you know I'm blemished. Help me. He said, I can't help you, you're so upside down. You have no other alternative but to come back again. Maybe in your next shot, in your next reincarnation, maybe then it'll work out. I came back again and again, the Amora this time. He said, I can't, you're finished, you're lost, you're such a crooked case, I can't help you. I don't have the capacity to help you. And he said, this kept on going on and on. And he's talking now from the higher level of awareness that he's been given now, this time, this story, 1895, the awareness of his neshama. Why was I suffering so much? I kept on coming back again and again. And other people, they got their tikkunim from this tzaddikim of each generation. But me not. Why? Why was I so upside down? And he said, now if I'm here in 1895, and the buck stops here. This is the last reincarnation. I will not come back again. This is my final rectification. Why? He said, because I had the good fortune of just knowing Rabbi Nachman's disciple, Rav Nosin, and that's already enough. What was so special about Rabbi Nachman? This is what he said in this story, from this revelation, that there was never a tzaddik from the time of Adam HaRishon until Rabbi Nachman, who so stressed and emphasized the way he did, Gevald, Ein Shum Yeush Ba'olam Ka. Gevald, there's no such thing as despair. In other words, the surety in making that statement, even though the idea appears in the Torah, appears in the Gemara, appears in the Midrash, we see it again and again, but emphasized to make a point that it's a wall. There's no such thing as despair, period. And with a surety to help people to bypass that, yes, there's no such thing as despair, and period, and that's it. Since Adam HaRishon until Rabbi Nachman's time, stressed it like he did. And he said that from this tzaddik, because of his stressing that there's always hope, even when the doors are closed, the heavens, they shake from such a tzaddik. And he said, now, this is my last gilgul, I'm not coming back. And he said on himself, the psukim we say in the Halal, Even ma'asu abonim, the stone which was discarded by the builders, in other words, my soul, the stone which is the souls, tishtapechna avni kodesh, which was discarded by the other tzaddikim or builders, the bonim of the Mishkan, this building. Haita lerosh pina. Not only am I now part of the edifice, the building, but I'm a chashuv part, I'm a cornerstone. Haita lerosh pina. Not only is it part of the building, but now, because I didn't give up and I kept on going, Now I'm part of the, I'm a chashuv part of the building. How come? Next pasuk. Me'et Hashem hayta zot, hi niflat beinein. How could you explain that somebody so far, somebody so crooked, could have such a choicest part in this edifice, in this structure, in Gan Eden also, like up there with the leading elite of the tzaddikim, and someone who was so low and blemished and everything, and just to lift him up like that, this you can't understand. Me'et Hashem hayta zot, it's from Hashem, hi niflat beinein, it's wondrous in ours. And then the next pasuk, ze hayom asa Hashem, nagila v'nismecha bo, and even today, the late, the end of history now, the 1800s now, the 1895 of this time, where the lower, the souls compared to the time of the Tanaim or the Moraim are much lower, even today, ze hayom asa Hashem, nagila v'nismecha bo. Even today, we can rejoice that such things can happen, that people so far can come so close. So basically, this is one of the main messages of Rabbi Nachman, one of the main messages of Pesach. What makes Rabbi Nachman stick out a lot is this message that even if there's a wall in front of you, you can make it, you can bypass it. I gave a share last night, I'll just go over some points about it, that there's a Gemara in Rosh Hashanah, or Daf Tet Zayin, or Daf Yud Zayin, which discusses, can tshuva really help, can prayer really help, can tzedakah really help? And they said, yes, the maskana is the Gemara, that tshuva, tefillah, tzedakah, can ma'avirin roa gzera, can break all decrees.
That's what we say in Rosh Hashanah.
Huh?
That's what we say in Rosh Hashanah.
Exactly, fine. So it's what the Gemara talks about, it's from the Gemara. The Gemara on Tet Zayin and Yud Zayin. So there, they say, what do we learn out? That the prayer can break a decree. And it's learned out from Tehillim, Psalms, chapter 107. Right? We've got the Arba Shetzichim Leodot, the four have to give thanks to Hashem. So they learn it, because it says, Vayitzaku el Hashem batzar lahem, mimetzukotehem yatzilem. We spoke about this last week also a bit on this verse, on this chapter 107. But the idea is that the Jews, they cry to Hashem, and He saves them. So the Gemara says, the Gemara asks, is it always the case that can a man break his decree? And they said, yes, but there's one exception. What's the exception? So we'll go through the list. If a tzibur davens, their prayer is always answered, even before the decree is sealed, and even after the decree is sealed, a tzibur, a group, can break it. How about a yachid? A yachid, an individual who cries out to Hashem for help, he can only break the decree if it's before the decree was sealed. But now, if the decree is sealed already on him, there's no hope on that. The Gemara says that, and the Gemara says, where's the proof to that? Look in chapter 107 itself. When it speaks about the fourth of the four people who have to give thanks to Hashem, Yordei Hayam, those who go in the sea. So if you look there, the guy was in the sea, and it's a sea storm, and he's in danger. And it says, Vayizaku el Hashem batzar lehem, umi mitzukotehem yatzilem. So there you have in the actual book of Psalms, in the actual Tanakh, you have the letter Nun written backwards six times there. And that backwards, the Gemara says, we learn from the backward nuns in Parashat Behalotcha in Bamidbar, the book of Bamidbar, on the Parashat Vahi bin So Aaron v'Yomer Moshe, you have two backward nuns there, right? Right before Vahi bin So Aaron is a backward nun, and afterwards also, which that Vahi bin So Aaron talks about when the cloud was ready to move. So Moshe, the cloud wouldn't move in the desert until Moshe Rabbeinu said, Kuma Hashem, rise, O God, and then the cloud would move. And then when Moshe saw the indication that the cloud wants the rest, that Hashem wants the Jews to stop here, so Shuvah Hashem, return, O God. So that's the parsha with two nuns before it that are backwards. Rashi explains why. To say that the real place of this parsha is not here. It's not supposed to be here. It's supposed to be 50 parshiot, not parsha of the week, but parshas in the actual seder of the week. 50 parshiot earlier, that's the place of this parsha. But the Gemara learns out there that the nun backwards, it comes to lema'et, it comes to exclude. This is not supposed to be here. It was put here for a specific reason. Rashi brings it down there. But it is not the right place. So too, by the guy in the sea, where the nun is backward six times, not just twice, it's to say that there is an exception to the crying out. And what is it? That an individual who davens to Hashem to save him, after the decree has been sealed, forget it. There's a chance that his prayer will not be answered. And the Mefarshim, the Maharsha, the Ben Ishchai, the commentators in Ein Yaakov, they explain, why are you learning it out from the seafarer? You have an example of a Yachid Rabin, you have a person in the desert, you have a person individually in the desert, and you have a group who's in the desert. You can have also an individual sick, and the people who are sick and they're crying out to Hashem. You have, and you also have a group of individual people in jail, and also you have a group, an individual of people who are on a ship crying out to Hashem. Why do you learn out a yachid from the fourth example? So that they explain that a person who's in danger on sea, because of the panic that it throws the person in, he doesn't pay attention to there's other people on deck with them on the ship. It's each person's individual. Even though they're a group of people together, from the panic of the danger of being at sea, they see themselves as an individual tzara, and it's never a tzibur crying out, Hashem, save us, on the boat. Each one is davening individually. It's also seen, by the way, on the story of Yonah, where each of the sailors, it says, cried to his God individually. They didn't pray to their as a group, but each one is mentioned as an individual. Fine. So you see, based on this, that there's a situation where there's no hope. Based on this Gemara, there's a situation there's no hope. And really, it contradicts the Gemara in Brachot of the story with Yeshayahu and Chizkiyahu Melech. That Yeshayahu came to tell Chizkiyahu Melech, that's it, you're finished, you're going to die. Hashem sent me to tell you that because now you don't want to get married and have kids, because you saw Ruach HaKodesh, that all your children are going to fall off the path and be wicked, because that you don't want to marry and have children, so Hashem decided that's it, you're sick now and you're going to die. So it says, Chizkiyahu said to Yeshayahu the prophet, leave. Leave, I don't want to hear you anymore. I have a Kabbalah from my ancestor David the Melech, the famous Gemara, Afilu Cherev Chada Munachat Al Tzavaro Shel Adam Al Yivna Atzumin Arachamim. Even if a sharp sword is on a person's neck, he should not restrain from compassion, from divine compassion. Leave me and I will daven. And he davened and he was saved. So here's an example of an individual, and Yeshayahu said it's too late, it's already after the decree has been sealed, there's no hope for you. So what's the case here? So we can understand from this something very amazing. What? That a yachid, when he's a yachid, then yes, he's in danger. So what to do? Make a yachid into a tzibur. How can I do that? This is another phenomenal teaching of Rabbi Nachman. The nun, the letter nun, corresponds to the number 50. What's the number 50? In Judaism we know, we have the Sfirat HaOmer, we have the 50 gates of Kedusha, the 50 gates of holiness. That is the climax. When we say that the Jews reached minus 49 in Egypt, and if they would have mitmameh, if they would have waited a little more in Egypt, they would have fallen to minus 50. And Moshe Rabbeinu was holding at a level that he reached in his lifetime, plus 49, in the levels of Kedusha, that's why he's able to pull out the Jews. When did Moshe Rabbeinu tap into level 50? In his passing. That's why he says he was buried in Har Nevo. Nevo means Nun Bo. He reached the level of 50 in his passing. He was buried in Har Nevo. That's when Moshe Rabbeinu tapped into level 50. So the 50, the Nun, signifies the level that Moshe Rabbeinu reached finally at the end in his passing together. So now when a Jew, the Yachid, the guy in the sea, the Nun is backwards. What does that mean? That I'm not connected to the letter Nun, the number Nun, the letter Nun, what it signifies, that Tzaddikim have reached level 50. Rather, it's turned away from me. What can I do? The concept, which is mentioned a lot in Rabbi Nachman's teachings, Hasidic teachings, in the Zohar and the Midrash, what's called Hitkashrut Tzaddikim, attachment to Tzaddikim, which is another wording for Lidabek B'Tamidei Chachamim, Emunat Chachamim, these terminologies which appear in Pirkei Avot, in the Gemara, throughout Torah literature, just reworded as karvut, coming close to tzaddikim. When you are close to a tzaddik, which means you believe in the tzaddikim, you believe in their teachings, you believe in their holiness, you are no longer alone. You're now not a yachid, you're a rabbi. This is illustrated in the Midrash, that Rabbi Akiva, when he saw his students dozing off, so he would throw these interesting words to get his students up. So one of them, the Midrash says, is that there was a woman in Egypt who gave birth to 600,000 people, right? So the students, they heard that, they woke up, what was this? And he said, yes, Yocheved gave birth to Moshe Rabbeinu, who's equivalent to 600,000 people. From where we learn the equation, that Moshe Rabbeinu is equal to the whole door. He's not an individual neshama, he's what's called an all-inclusive neshama. That's the neshama of the tzaddikim. So meaning, when a person is close to the tzaddikim, he's no longer a yachid, he's considered, not necessarily halachically, we need a 10 people, we need a quorum, fine. But in this concept of being a davening, which is tefillat yachid, if now you are close to tzaddikim, meaning you follow their advice and how you delve into Hashem, you believe in them, you try to have close proximity in them, you are now no longer a yachid, you're a rabbin, and like the pasuk says, hen el kabir lo imas, hen, behold, el, the Lord Hashem, kabir, something which is heavy, strong, a minyan, a quorum, a group, lo imas, Hashem doesn't deny it, Hashem answers it, which means zochem is at Hashem, through Pesach, to realize our potential, especially through the tzaddikim, to respect, recognize, and understand that today, to survive today, we need desperately the teachings of the tzaddikim to survive, because as we can see openly, the Jews left and right are not holding on, are not making it, whether in the frum world, the non-frum world, whatever, we see to live today, to survive today, is becoming almost impossible. So therefore, a higher level of Kedusha, which is out there available, is necessary just for basic survival today. We should be zochet to find it. Find these tzaddikim who can infuse with us this light, this Kedusha, this whatever you want to call it, and bezat Hashem to make it and come to our potential and to see.